Okay, Craig, if you could do a roll call, please.
Jeff Swearingen.
Present.
Patrick Updike.
You're on the phone.
Jeff Sundholm.
Present. Present.
Thank you. Marty Smith.
Present.
Tom Lampe.
Present.
John Benson.
Present.
Bob Von Wolfrat.
I'm on the phone.
Thank you. Denise Pavlik.
Present on the phone.
Thank you. Andy Buffington.
Present.
Ellen Hagen. Deb Krebel. David Ness. Jason Leonard.
Here.
Michael Casper. Carolyn Smith.
Present.
Linda Fredrickson. Kelly Grossgirth. Missing one.
Is there anyone on the phone that missed a roll call for attendance of board member? Okay, we'll continue to get on the phone and see if we can get one more. In the meantime, we'll do introduction of board members. I'm gonna start down at the end, John.
John Benson with Department of Homeland Security and Emergency Management.
Andy Buffington with Winnebago and Hancock County Emergency Management 911 representing Communication Centers.
Jeff Swearingen, Department of Natural Resources.
Jason Leonard, Waverly Police Department representing Municipal Police. Tom Lampe, DPS.
Craig Allen, SWCC.
Carolyn Smith, Iowa Law Enforcement Academy.
Jeff Sundholm, DOT.
Marty Smith, Iowa Department of Public Health.
Anybody on the phone for board members? Introduce yourselves, please.
Patrick Updike, Iowa Department of Corrections.
Denise Pavlik, Scott Emergency Communications Center.
Bob Von Wolfrat, State CIO.
Okay, welcome everybody. We'll skip past to the SWCC report. In the meantime, we're working on getting one more member to join us on the call so we can go through the minutes in the agenda. Craig, if you could go ahead on the SWCC report.
The first thing I want to cover is that I've been spending a lot of time this month for an upcoming LMR summit that will be hosted by the CIO and myself. The summit will be held March 13th. It will be held in this room. And the intent of the summit is to have 3 one-hour blocks to basically cover what ISICS is and isn't in the first hour, what the MOA, if you wish to join, requires that you do to join and what the benefits of that might be. And then in the third hour, talk about the ISSI switch that we've been reporting back on for some time and how the ISSI switch works or what it will do, what it won't do, what it will pass, what it won't pass. And the reason that this is important is because our system is a TDMA system, time division, multiple access, versus what most of the state of Iowa operates in, which is frequency division, multiple access, or FDMA. And so as a member, as your voting member on TIA, I have had multiple conversations with the engineering teams, not sales teams, the engineering teams, on how TDMA and FDMA systems work. And across the multiple vendors, the answers change just a little bit. And so as we look at what the future may bring us, most counties have hired a consultant if they're looking at making a choice about what they're going to do in the future. So there's two primary audiences. The first audience would be the users, the county points of contact, and who, whatever agencies may have an interest in attending. The second would be the consultants or the advisors to those users. And I realize everybody's not going to want to come. Many people have their minds made up, know what they're going to do, or are already deciding to not do anything. That's fine. The purpose of the summit is for those people that are on the bubble over the next 24 months, give them an opportunity to understand what the interoperability components are. And I say that because If you look at what other states have done, and any, or even as a county, if a county is rolling out a system, until you actually have dial tone and people can go try it themselves, there's just a lot of mystery to it. You're moving from a 1933 rock solid typewriter to an Apple iPad, and it's a huge jump. And so what it can and can't do, and what it will and won't do, is it'll do a lot more, but it's how it does it that makes it, and how to get to it can be a lot more complicated. So that's the purpose of having this particular summit. There will be more, but this first one will be scheduled for March 13th. And so what the audience for that, I've explained that, who we expect to have in the room, in this room, would be three members of TIA. I've spoken to them and asked them to come. The representative, the chair of all of the committees for TIA, the chair of the TDMA two-slot committee, and the chair of the ISSI switch committee. So those three areas should cover all of the standards that P25 operates in, and we won't have to worry about, well, it should do this or it should do that. These gentlemen, and in this case, they're all men, will be able to tell us exactly what it can and can't do in the event someone wants to do something or thinks that it can do something. So the purpose of it is as we walk out that door at the end of the day, the consulting community will have a better set of questions answered. The users will have a better understanding of what the system is and isn't, if they wish to join it, how they go about joining it, and what that process is to get that done. And so that's the primary purpose of the 3 1-hour blocks. We will record those, and they will be uploaded to YouTube as 3 1-hour blocks. So if someone has a question, hey, I couldn't make it, I missed it, I'd like to watch that, they can do it, or they have a question, you want to go back to it, you don't have to go through a 3-hour session. You can take a look at just a 1-hour block and figure out what, if that particular topic is the area of your interest. So does any board members have any questions about that particular element?
I missed the date. Did you announce the date?
Yes, it is March 13th.
And it is
will
here?
It will be in this room from 1 to 4.
Okay. I did hear a beep on the phone. Who joined us on the call? Heard another beep. Is there a board member that joined us on the call?
Dave Ness.
Okay. I believe that will make the quorum.
Yes, sir, it will.
Okay. So let's back up. Unless you have questions for Craig on his summit, I'll open that up and let that continue. Otherwise, we can talk about it later in the agenda also.
Let's go on and we'll let the questions marinate.
So we'll back up, and if I could get approval of today's agenda, please. A motion for that? Okay. Andy, do you have a second? Okay, but second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. Approval for the meeting minutes from January 12th of 17. Actually, I believe that's probably, what was the call date for the official board meeting? The other one was just a business meeting.
January 26th.
Did everybody get those minutes from that? Get approval for those, the meeting minutes from that date, please? Take a motion for that.
I move.
Marty.
Okay, Marty. Got a second? Jason, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion passes. On to, are you finished with your report? Do you have more, or should we move?
I wanted to report to the board, if I could, that that I attended the TIA meeting in Florida last week. I can't overstate the value of the information that we're able to collect there, particularly for the technology committee, and why that's important for Iowa. It is much less expensive than we had initially anticipated when I taken a look at the travel and what it cost to go there. I think we budgeted $15,000, and I know Kelly isn't on the call, but I would be surprised if we've exceeded $8,000, including our membership. So it's been a very efficient use of dollars. But the ability to go in and talk with these ladies and gentlemen that are actually developing the standards and have a hand in getting a true understanding of what the motivation is and what they're trying to achieve. In many instances, we've been able to help shape that towards users' perspectives as opposed towards engineering. And I say that from this way. When you fill a room with engineers, they write to engineering thinking. The challenge is that most of the people that pick up a gun, a fire hose, or a Band-Aid aren't. And they need it to be simple and elegant and work quickly and not have to go through three different moves to get it done. So as we look at the standards elements of that, your board and two others are generally in the room, South Carolina and now the Washington Capitol Complex. And so we're able to help that conversation along in getting into the simplicity of it, which means the engineering has to get more rigorous, which is fine. But the good news is that there's a lot of value added coming out of that. And I think there may be another opportunity here before too long, Mr. Chair, for someone else from Iowa to be involved in the TI elements from a slightly different perspective. And I think that will be good for Iowa and particularly good for us, because keep in mind, we're doing a TDMA system. This hasn't been done anyplace else. We're the first one. And so there's a lot of lessons that we're going to learn and a lot of lessons that the standards still have gaps in them that have to be filled. And so being at the table, being able to have those cup of coffee or a conversation with the vendor community at that moment, very, very valuable. I think I'll leave it at that so we don't take up too much more time. We're
okay.
10:41 right now, but
okay.
Thank you.
Thank
I'll
you.
Answer any questions.
Questions for the SWIC? Helen, are you here today? Give a report, please.
Good morning, Chair Lampe. Good morning, board, guests. I handed out this to the board, public safety, enhanced user interface, R&D roadmap, and this is a draft. The final isn't done. This is one of the national projects that I've been working on for the past year. This is coming to an end. This is the draft document that's being sent to NIST for final inspection and editing, but we're done with this project. We're not going to meet as a working group. It's just going to be edited and then sent up. So I wanted to give you, this is your sneak peek. What I'd like to do is put a draft watermark on it and email you the full document so you can have a chance to look through it before it's published. But I didn't want to print 119 pages and kill any trees. But I wanted to give you an idea of what I've been working on this year with the public safety research, communications research folks. So I did print off some of the most important pages, and that was the executive summary, the purpose. And the important thing about the purpose of what we're doing is these roadmaps are created. This is one of three roadmaps that NIST is using in order to determine where to spend $3 million in grant money that they have left over from the sale of some spectrum that was done in the Middle Class Tax Relief Act. So, and that explains that on page 9, the purpose in the middle paragraph. So they have some money to spend. So these roadmaps were put together by the working groups. This is one of three, and I was on this user interface committee to determine how best to grant out this money to the public safety community. And then if you look at the next page 10 and page 16, that page 10 gives you an idea of who our audience is, our intended audience, but that also gives you an idea of who is in the working group. So that's the federal agencies, academia, industry, public safety, and state and local government decision makers. That really explains who is on the working group as well, but that's also who our audience is for this roadmap. This was definitely a public-private partnership working group, and we have a public-private audience that we're going through. So it's industry plus government. Page 16 shows you what our framework is for the roadmap. So before we put anything together, we had a framework in mind for what we were planning to do. So we had an operational objective for enhancing, an operational objective for expanding and evolving, the user interface. We looked at trends and drivers first, and that's pretty much what I focused on with you. A lot of the I had a lot of fun with the trends and drivers section, and was happy to find some direct quotes in there because I had a lot of fun typing up some stuff for them for that one. So, considerations for public safety's expanded use of user interface. That was an interesting thing. I'm not going to read these pages to you, but what I printed out for you is some stuff. And what we did was we broke it up to 0 to 5 years, 5 to 10 years, and 10 to 20 years. So this is a 20-year outlook on where technology would be for the public safety community, public safety user. And we broke it out in these chunks, and what the trends and drivers would be, what would be the capabilities, and what would be the things getting in the way, what would be the roadblocks to those things that they needed. So, like I said, it's a 119-page report. If you look at page 28, at the very top, it talks about FirstNet and public safety broadband. So FirstNet was definitely a huge part of looking at the future, of course. Because we're looking at LMR eventually being taken over by LTE. We were talking about a 20-year time span, right? We're talking about them working side by side. And then we're talking about them being replaced eventually. What does that look like to the user? What does that look like to public safety? So that 119 pages is filled with use cases, examples of use cases in fire, EMS, and police, of what that would look like. What does it look like if mission critical push-to-talk works? What does it look like if you're using just regular POC, push-to-talk over cellular? Not mission critical, but what would it look like? Like, say, when we used it at the fair, the state fair, when we used WAVE, that was push-to-talk over cellular. That's not mission critical push-to-talk. So there is these different use cases where we used, you know, LMR, LTE plus LMR, and just LTE, the whole evolution of technology from today to 20 years from now. What this working group. So if you want to see the people on the very last page that I printed out for you is the appendix of all the folks that worked on it from the different walks of life. So we had, like I said, the academia, the federal agencies in the R&D area, universities, state and local governments, industry, private industry, a very diverse group of folks worked on this. We had several states, Victoria from Hawaii, one of our SWCC friends was there, and a lot of FirstNet people were with us as well. So I think you'll enjoy looking through it if you get a chance, and maybe some of you won't be interested, but I think some of you will. You have any questions on that?
I kind of have Jason? A question that might be a little bit longer. When you're talking about the findings of what voice over LTE or voice over internet or and the push to talk, the case studies that you were talking about that's filled in these 119 pages, did you study those? Did you study those at all and have a finding of what is to come? And you said it's basically within the next 20 years. So what were those findings, I guess, is what my question would be, if there was any. Or is it just...
Well, mission critical push-to-talk is not working yet, right?
Right.
So it's being developed on 5G, I think, is the plan for 3GPP, the folks that actually design it. So it's actually not physically available right now. But what we're doing with the use cases is we're looking at what would the use case be for it, and what would be what would be the problems with it? I mean, they've tested some codecs or some encoders or vocoders. They tested some vocoders, they've chose a vocoder, and they know what they're going to use for it. So they've gotten to a certain extent in the lab with it, to the point where they know what's going to work in a high noise, loud environment. So, but the use cases are more about the, it's all about the user interface. So if we're going to use, if we're going to use something that's attached to the body, or like, you know, it's more than just mission critical push to talk, it's about haptic feedback. It's about, you know, think of the future. Think of a smart shirt.
Right.
Or an embedded microphone that's going to know, you know, when to open, when to close, you know, those types of things, and what's going to be in the way. I mean, I'm not sure I'm answering your question correctly.
I just, what I'm looking for mainly is, because the question that comes up all the time is when you're talking about radio usage, mission critical data, or mission critical
voice,
is that the question that always comes up from a lot of locals is that how far off are we by using mission critical over LTE?
How far off are we? That's a good question.
That's a question that comes up, I think, regularly, because of the work that you know, the statewide platform is doing with the LMR system and what's to come. Is that what we're talking about?
I would be surprised to see it 2020 at the earliest. What do you think, Craig?
I'm glad you asked that question, because at the engineers at our FirstNet conference, I posed that question because it was one of their slides in the slide deck, if you'll recall. And the answer was, that's probably 10 years out. Now,
years?
I don't know that well, the reason is one-to-many, the one-to-one layup shot. The one-to-many and the time delays to meet the millisecond delay pieces is where the engineers start having trouble. So they may have that fixed by now, but at that time, it was generally accepted that it would be about 10 years before you were going to see just general marketplace purchasing of LTE push-to-talk equipment at all levels. So that's not to say that your leaders, the larger communities, the places where you have the greater prevalence, aren't going to be out there using it in a time shorter than that, but about 10 years before it was generally accepted and everyone was using it. So.
Yeah, I think that's, I'm thinking released by 3GPP. So then there's that whole, so you're probably, yeah, I see my timeline, I'm probably thinking more on a engineering type timeline released by.
You get the manufacturers to build it. You got to get the users to buy it. They've got to test it and make sure it works.
True
there
that.
Has to be a trust level, and there has to be standards on the equipment side of the consumer and then back into the network. So. As you start looking at all of those public safety aspects of it, 10 years didn't seem irrational
right.
to me.
Well, thanks.
Well said. Anyone else? Okay, for the regions, is Rob still here?
Back.
There he is.
Rob, did you want to talk about Region 1 at all? Or? Okay. So what we have going on for, we don't have, the regions haven't been meeting regularly from the holidays too much. Region 3 has an engagement coming up February 22nd. That would be Glenn Sedevi. Glenn, are you on the phone? So Region 3 Chair Glenn Sedevi is having a ISICS radio, I guess you could call it a summit, with Motorola and Electronic Engineering, an ISICS Q&A. It's a lunch and learn. So it's a quick hour and a half during the lunch hour, come lunch and learn about the ISICS state radio system. on February 22nd in his region. So he's doing that, and he's also pushing out the FirstNet articles that John Tell sends. John Tell Harris forwards some FirstNet articles as part of the FirstNet Broadband Committee's info. He pushes that out to his, he's got a member team now, and he pushes that out on a regular basis. So Region 3's picked up a lot of steam, and Region 2 had they did a big outreach in November, so they've grown by 6 members since November. So there's still some steam there. For future, we've got Andy and I are meeting with the UGC, of course, next week, and we have some additional information we're going to share with them about a 2017 RIC strategy, and that's just part of the regular UGC meeting is to discuss the RICs. So, and that's really all I have for the regional. We, you know, Sean's working on some things, but for Sean and John Teller are working on some things for the Metro engagements with ISICS and FirstNet, but that's something that Sean can report on, I think, better than I can. So.
Okay.
Thanks, Helen.
Okay. Thanks, everyone.
Okay, we can move on to Blake here.
Be enough for the board. These are actually left over from the council meeting, but it'll work for what I'm talking about too. Our department has introduced a 911 bill. We had a webinar earlier this week. It's also available on our website for those that haven't seen this presentation. You just Google HSCMB 911. Our website will be the first hit, and that webinar recording is on there. It's about 30 minutes long, so I will try to do the very short version here. The first slide. I think a lot of people have seen the consolidation study. That lists basically the executive summary of recommendations. The red are the recommendations that we did not carry forward into the legislation. Moving on, the crux of the bill basically is for the legislature to give us the nod, the go-ahead to continue down this path towards looking at merging the wireline and the wireless network into a single network. We think we can save a significant amount of money. We would absorb those costs that currently local service boards pay for the wireline. The other component of that is a virtual network of call processing equipment, where it would allow us to have 6 CPEs, that's the call processing equipment, in the various ladder regions of the state. That's done for a very specific reason. If we can aggregate that wireline traffic to those internal to those LATA boundaries, we save the money of not having to ship that voice over across the LATA boundaries. So we aggregate it at those 6 points, and then we can ship that traffic for 911 calls anywhere in the state that we need to. So the idea behind this bill is to not mandate the physical closure of any PSAPs, but to try to save money other places, such as virtual consolidation, merging the wireline and wireless networks. The goal for that then is to get for the end user, the PSAP, the local service board, that cost to be free. It would also not be mandatory at this point. The idea being, again, that it becomes a viable option that the next time they look to upgrade their equipment that's in their back room, our host remote equipment becomes a viable solution for them. We take a lot of the maintenance, the upgrade costs off their hands, and then they connect into this network. A couple other things to mention on the funding issues. This bill does not suggest to change the wireline funding structure whatsoever. That funding would still go to the local service boards. It also does not touch the wireless pass-through amounts. That would remain at 60% to local service boards. It has some other cleanup language, basically modernizing the code section a little bit, removing the E or enhanced 911s, and just going strictly with 911. Are there any questions on that? And I should add at this point, it's been delivered to the leadership of both the House and the Senate, but it does not have an official number unless it does in the last 20 minutes.
Actually, I did just get a number in the last 20 minutes. It's on the Senate. The 911 bill on the Senate side is Senate Study Bill 1082. I'm looking to see if the House read it in this morning.
This is fresh.
Yeah, it hasn't been read into the House yet either. So once we get that, I'll let you know.
So again, we'll continue to update the 911 stakeholders, our various distribution lists, emergency managers, where that is, as it progresses through both sides of the Capitol. Another topic I've been bringing up, I think it's relevant. Annually, the FCC has done a diversion report, and it's usually a very simple form. At least that's how it started. It's grown over the last few years. It's a lot more all-encompassing about 911 data, where states are with next-gen upgrades. And historically, the primary question or the purpose behind that report is to ask if states have diverted 911 funds. And until this year, the FCC has always taken the answer and reported based on what states self-reported. This is the first year that the FCC has looked at the answers that states have provided and interpreted on the state's behalf the answer if states have diverted funds for 911 or not. So this year we ended up on the list of states that diverted funds for other public safety reasons. There was another group of states that diverted funds for general fund purposes. We're not on that list. We're on the list of states that diverted funds for other public safety purposes. We talked to the FCC, we talked to the National 911 Office about exactly what that means. And the worry has always kind of been, if you end up on that list, you may become ineligible for future 911 grants. In talking with the office that manages those future 911 grants, the application period for these future 911 grants is going to open probably around December and January. And as long as, and their message was, as you apply for that, you have to certify that you have not diverted funds in the previous 6 months. So in theory, come December or January, we should hopefully be able to certify that we have not diverted any funds. The other thing we're going to do in the future, missed a little step here, and that is this stems from how we answered the question on the payment of the LMR, the lease payments that came out of 911. Perfectly legal by Iowa code, but the way the FCC interpreted our answer and what we did to pay that, they interpreted it as the diversion. So we talked with the FCC. They said we have a couple different avenues that we could approach this from. We could go the public comment route. That didn't seem to be too worthwhile. And the other avenue was that we could file some additional information. They said they've never done a second version of the report before. Didn't really sound too promising that they would do it this year, but they could also just take that information and just basically as an FYI to the FCC. What we chose to do is next year, we will answer that question in a different way, try to provide more information, try to provide the explanation on why we believe this was not a diversion, should not be considered a diversion and being used for 911 purposes. But did want to make sure that the board was aware that those discussions were going on. Were there any questions on that? And then finally, just an update on text to 911. We're converting about 1 to 3 PSAPs a week, enabling that text to 911. We're up to 20 at this point and still on target to be done statewide by the end of June. If there's no other questions, that concludes my report.
All right. Chair Buffington. User group.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman. As Helen indicated, the user group committee, as we support the RICS, the regional interoperable committees have been sparsely populated during their meetings. Some haven't had any activity. Region 2 continues to meet, and as Helen indicated, Glenn in Region 3 is going to be ramping up. So a week from today, down at Oran Pape, we're going to be having having an in-person UGC meeting where obviously all the RIC chairs are invited, and just to kind of try to put some more energy back into the Regional Interoperable Committee. During our time talking about the RICs, it was brought up about some of the information stemming from Craig's letter that went out statewide, that there were some questions that some of the locals in one of the regions had. They forwarded that to Craig. Haven't heard anything back from them or from Craig yet, and I haven't asked either, in fairness. It was just basically clarification issues. Some of those things that keep coming up in some of the questions from the locals, they're still out there. And so we turned our discussion to the need for what the RICs are really desiring right now is a need for information to pass down. They want to be able to tell their people what the status of LMR, what does it mean specific to their area. Now, the newsletter that's going through talking about, you know, the work being done in certain counties, that's valuable. And hopefully we're going to continue to have our RIC chairs subscribe to that information and continue to pass it down to people. But they said they would really like to see us linking more with some of the professional organizations. Obviously, ISSDA, Iowa Emergency Management, NENA, APCO, are the firefighter groups, professional and IFA. Just that maybe we need to reach out to them specifically to try to make a presence. I know we have. I'm not saying we haven't. But there was a little bit of talk, discussion, and some energy talking about the need for more information and outreach. The applicant review panel this next week, we're going to be making that a little bit more solid as a subcommittee of the user group committee. This is going to be a small membership that is going to be going out to future applicants, any current applicants, as well as those who have already had a preliminary application approved by the board, to go and work with them and try to see what we can do from a board perspective to so that they really, and as Craig had reported during the 911 council meeting, to really, so that those applicants understand what that means is it to join ISICS. We also talked about needing to expand our membership on the UGC. Between that discussion and the last few days, I see that Chair Lampe has made a plea to some of those state agencies for recommendations. And it also led into the concern from the UGC about not having emergency management represented. Right now there's an EMA vacancy. I've stated earlier that I called the governor's office back in November and was told that we would have, there was a couple representatives specific to some of the openings that would be filled by the first of the year. Here we are in February, and it seems like from some of the discussion at the previous meeting at the 911 council that it looks like it could be up to June possibly until we get something. And I don't know where we're at on that. Mike Bryant was talking about that, but I think there needs to be some energy, because they brought up the fact that last month we didn't have a quorum, and they said that doesn't that doesn't change the business of the board, but they said that doesn't look good to the locals out there. That what kind of interest is there statewide if those of us appointed to the board can't attend the meetings? And that's not a reflection on the membership, but the fact that there's been a vacancy in emergency management since Samantha went from a local onto a state agency and resigned her position as emergency management. So I guess if anybody has a voice with the governor's office, I understand there's changes going on there, but I think that needs to be addressed. And then also, I guess I'm looking for some guidance. I'd sent an email to you, Chair Lampe. There's a vendor, essentially a radio shop that operates in the state of Iowa that's requested ISICS access, which if you look at our MOA, they're not. It has to be a governmental entity that has a public safety discipline. So just some guidance, if the letter of saying that I'm sorry, but that's not allowed comes from the chair, from the board in general, or from the UGC, I'm looking for any discussion or guidance on how exactly we're going to handle that, because it's I received it just late last week, so I need to act on that as soon as I possibly can.
So the answer to that is it's illegal, and there will be a letter typed up the rules for that and what the rules are.
Right. And it's very clear in the MOA. One of the first paragraphs talks about that you as the applicant are a
government entity with a public safety discipline operating in your jurisdiction. Correct. And that's all I have, unless anyone has any questions.
I did meet with Motorola yesterday, 2 days ago, about the attendance of them on the UGC. And they will be supplying a permanent and a backup on that, and they will be at your meeting next week.
Right, and I've always invited Mr. Mercado, and he usually attends on the phone more than often, but I did get an alternate. Stephen sent me that name in the last couple days, so thank you.
Okay. Okay, we'll move on to finance. I think Craig is going to read this one for us.
Chair Grosker sent me an email that says the finance report is as follows. Appropriations from the state funds available, $210,664.97. And she has already removed from the balance in the event that there is a requirement to deobligate $39,000. There was some discussion that the governor's office had made state agencies aware of certain dollar amounts that they were expecting to be, this is I'm ad-libbing now, removed. And Mr. Benson might be able to give us an update, but I think there were some things working their way through the legislature that may or may not actually have that occur. And so we were in a defensive posture of wanting to make the board aware that at the state level, that's how it's done. You don't take your bills into the city council each week. You do it once a year. And then if the executive branch would do some form of a deobligation, which is to take money back, if you will, from the agencies, and this board acts as a board or commission. So they have a budget and they can have it deobligated. The number that we had been given was $39,000. That may or may not be in the legislation, but we wanted the board to be prepared for that. And Chair Grosskreutz felt that there may be a need for a motion because we pass our budget in the form of a motion. But at this point, that number isn't aware, but I will defer to Mr. Benson if you have anything that you think we should do.
Okay. No, the deobligation bill did pass both chambers. It was signed by the governor. I believe DPS Finance does have the number that they need. So I would make a motion that instructing DPS Finance to reduce that amount out of the board's appropriate annual appropriation.
Like they already did, but we could do that.
Board should give a formal approval.
Okay. I have a motion to indicate. So read me your motion one more time.
That the DPS Finance reduce the amount of the annual appropriation given to the Essex Board in the amount as specified in the deappropriation bill passed by the legislature and signed by the governor.
Okay. A motion on the floor for Mr. Benson. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Leonard. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. I believe $210,664.97 reflects the amount now minus the 39.
Correct. That's the number. That's a number that she had provided.
All right.
Second, with regard to the SLGP grant, this month we expended $40,814.59, of which 80% was paid by the federal grant. The amount remaining in that grant is $710,712.67. And I believe that concludes the balance of the report that needs to be in for this month's meeting. I'll take any questions. That's it.
I assume we have no travel requests?
No.
Okay. Governance Committee, Mr. Benson.
All right, the Governance Committee meeting was very brief this month as the chair forgot to call the meeting, as the chair was busy doing other things. But leftovers from the last couple of months, and we do still have, and I guess the board needs to decide if they want to formally approve, and since it's not on the agenda, we can't do it today, but if the board wants to formally approve the procedure for appointing voting members for the UGC, or if the committee can just provide that directly to the chair, I would default to the wishes of the board. I would not recommend, based on the discussions that occurred last month in the meeting, I would not recommend any changes to as it stands. There was some discussion about how to address removal from the committee, for lack of a better way of saying it. I am not in favor of that in any way, shape, or form, because you will have, it's three-year terms, you will have staggered three-year terms, and it does create a bit of a perception if we allow the chair to, for whatever reason, remove people from the committee. That's, in my mind, is bad optics. It creates the perception, right or wrong, of stacking the UGC to go a particular direction. I don't believe that is the intent of the UGC in any way, shape, or form. So I will default to whatever the board wishes. If they just want us to pass that up to the chair, or if they want to formally approve it to the chair, if they do, we can do that. We can certainly handle that at the next meeting. We'll put it on the agenda.
Anybody questions for John, or either way?
Then I'm just going to pass it on. I don't need board approval. We'll just pass it on to the chair, and the chair can use it. And then next, I know next meeting we will bring forward the formal request to have DPS, their rule writing staff, the administrative rules writing staff, to make changes to Section 661, Chapter 600. It's very minor stuff, but and it's the reason I'm not pushing to get it done today is it's not that important. So
that's the number of board members?
Yep.
Okay.
That's precisely what it is. That would be the limit of my report today.
Okay, thank you. Operations.
I have just a quick report on the central trailer. Thanks to Scott Richardson from DPS, he installed the UPS system that had shorted out, and that is operational. That's all I have to report.
No fires, huh?
No, not today.
What?
No, I did. Marty, I just need to make you aware, and I'll get you the documents. I believe we are at the end of the battery life cycle of those batteries, and as part of the RFP, the vendor was required to replace those batteries. How long have we had those? 5 years now? Mm-hmm. At the end of 5 years, they were required to replace every mobile battery. I'll get you the document and the contact information so you guys can reach out and get them done on all three.
Thank you, sir.
On the portables? Really? The batteries?
Yes.
Good deal. All right. Is there anybody from outreach? Is Helen not? Is anyone, I know she's.
I didn't hear her on the call. Helen, were you able to join us on the call? What about Sandy Morris? Were you able to join us?
I think Sean could probably handle that part.
Thank you, Chair and Council. So today, as you saw, the newsletter went out last night. I said it was going to go out. Unfortunately, I wish it would have gone out a little sooner. But you know, when you're trying to make sure everything looks good and works, it takes a little longer. So it did go out. If you have recommendations or suggestions, please contact me directly. I'll definitely take them under consideration. We hope that, you know, we can keep everyone better informed about what's going on. And as you saw in the top part of the newsletter, if you saw it, counties in which we're doing active radio construction, modification, stuff like that, things that are happening right now. We are also working on the website to make sure that it's easier for you to find where to join the ISIX platform and how to contact us and how to work through those processes and procedures. Beyond that, Helen has been actively looking at how to make sure that everyone in the outreach committee is actively going after the associations as per Chair Buffington's comments. So we are looking at that. The newsletter currently goes out to, I want to say, about 3,000 people. So as you can imagine, we're trying to hit every person on the county supervisor list, every sheriff's office, we're still working to get out all the police contacts, every fire contact, every EMA, PSAP, and 911 designated point of contact. If you are not one of those people and you want to contact me, we're also going to make sure that in the newsletter there is a subscribe option. So we're trying to make sure that no one feels like you were missed. We'd rather opt everyone in versus opt out, kind of like FirstNet. So with FirstNet, that's a big part of the newsletter as well. It's not just the ISIX radio platform or the board. That is a big part of it. And so we're trying to make sure that you're getting informed with things that are posted directly from FirstNet. So anything that's posted directly from FirstNet or anything we feel that you should see immediately, that will also be part of the newsletter. We don't have a solid schedule of the newsletter and when it's going to go out yet. We believe it's going to go out once a month. So I want to make sure I don't set the bar too incredibly high that I can't deliver for you every single time, but it will be once a month for sure. What that date will be is still to be determined, but next month it will be not the day before the board meeting.
Sean, last month we had a little confusion. There was a member that asked, not a board member, but a member of the audience said, oh, I don't think I got a particular document from the board because they were looking at from the SWIC or something like that. Mm-hmm. Could you share with the audience what the email address actually is that shows up on their inbox?
Yeah, thank you. That's a great comment. The email will be from iowanet@iowa.gov. That way we have built-in redundancy so that if one of us would be gone or change positions or anything else, we had to build in redundancy. So all the emails are sent from iowanet@iowa.gov. And we also are looking at unsubscribers because we have about 77 unsubscribers. So if a new sheriff would come in, and your county sheriff said, I don't want this stuff, and they unsubscribed, and you take over that county sheriff email, you're not going to get the message. I'm definitely open for any ways that I can help you make sure that you're always getting it. I can publish the list of who are our unsubscribers, because my biggest fear is that your county sheriff, whoever they may be a current subscriber, the new county sheriff takes over, and they're like, I'm out of the loop of all this information. How did this happen? And all I can do is say, well, I have to follow FCC regulations on spam, the spam, Can Spam Act. So when they ask me to unsubscribe, I unsubscribe. But as you can imagine, when the position changes, situations change. So I'm definitely open to any suggestions on how you may want me to handle that. Like I said, right now we've worked with a couple of associations, and one of the association was the Emergency Management Association. And we did contact them and explain to them that, hey, I don't know if you knew this, but that's coming from us, and you put us on the unsubscribe list. So, and I know everyone's very busy, so that's why I try and make sure that if I think it's an error, I try and make sure to bring it to their awareness. Any other questions or comments? The WISE, I will make two more, sorry. The WISE pilot video, we are working to finalize that in the next month. That will be a big part of just helping people understand what's going on with WISE, the Wi-Fi Internet for School Emergencies. We've been out working with the three towns, Marshalltown, Norwalk, and Martinsdale, to make sure we have video, making sure we have video of all the people. We're looking at making sure that we also increase our workings with the EMS folks, because they're typically on high schools quite often with different sports events. And then the telecommunicator video, we have now confirmed about four different dispatching offices that are willing to allow us to interview their dispatchers. We may get to five in the end. So we're trying to give the truest reflection of our telecommunicators and in their different offices, whether they be a sheriff's office, a local PD, a private, kind of like Westcom, or associated with EMA. So any other questions?
Okay. All right. Thanks,
Thank
Sean.
You.
We move on to training. Is Denise on the phone?
Very brief meeting, but most of what we talked about, the biggest thing that we talked about was the technical assistance requests. I provided everybody with the document that Craig had passed along to me, the draft document. I shared that with all of them. I asked them to review it to provide any comments. At this time, I have not heard any comments back. We do have our next meeting next Wednesday, where they can have one last opportunity to provide any additional comments on that document, and then I will forward those on to Craig, and we can talk about that. From my perspective, I think that what we're asking are all of the things that on the technical committee, or I'm sorry, on the training committee, those are the things that we've been asking for. So at this point in time, I think that it looks fairly comprehensive. So again, our meeting was pretty relatively short, and that's all I have to report.
Denise, this is Craig. We, at the 911 Council, they had indicated that they're putting together a budget that may allow for training dollars to be used in the furtherance of the 911 mission. And I briefed them that we had made requests, technical assistance requests in the past, coming out of that committee that had focused in that 911 space. And as part of the ecosystem, it made sense to me that if we could align getting technical assistance dollars from the federal government to bring in resident experts to train us, that perhaps the 911 council dollars could be used to reimburse those folks to come and take the training, because it's probably, you know, you can't hold it in everybody's center. So as we look at this, as we look at the TA, that may be something that we want to make sure that we coordinate with Blake and his team to make sure that we're kind of aligned with what their thinking is as we look forward. Thank you.
Great. Thanks.
Okay, technology. Chair Updike, are you on the phone?
Yes, I am.
Proceed. Thank you.
Okay, the technology committee met on January 26th, and one of the first topics was some of the interfacing issues that could possibly exist with outside agencies and how to get those legacy systems to work with the new P25 system. It really didn't get into a lot of the technical aspects as it did the some of the aspects of just dealing with the policies and standardization. What are those things that need to be done from a standardized point to make these things work? Do we work with each other? Do we separate ourselves? These are all questions and discussions that came up, and I don't know, maybe Craig Allen would like to expand on that a little bit more, but the overall attitude was that from a technical standpoint, we all need to work together to get these agencies in one form or another to interface with the system so that it works for them and a P25 system. Craig, I don't know, do you want to expand on that a little bit?
Thank you. Yes, and to that end, the first step in that process is going to be the summit that we'll be holding in March. There'll be more summits coming, but the letter generated discussion, and now
we hope that the summit answers that set of questions, but it will raise a whole nother set of questions. And how do we interface? And the good news is that we've avoided the need to narrow band later. The bad news is that we're way out on the front end of this in a statewide system. And so we're getting a lot of learning curves, and moving from VHF to this is gonna be a lot of fun. So I think I'll leave it at that.
Well, that particular subject took up all of our meeting time, so we ended up adding another follow-up meeting on the 31st of January. At that point, we went back to the subject of the ISIC-MC 12B policy that's out there for public viewing. After that was all dealt with, I worked with Alan Trojanovich to get that put on the web page for public viewing, since that did pass, and that'll be out there till the March meeting. One of the concerns that came up with this public viewing of this document is once we get it put in place and it passes through board approval, how do we get these things out to the agencies so that they know that it's there and they can see it and follow it? So we decided that we probably need to spend a little bit more time with the outreach people and possibly have these documents from the technical committee pushed out on a newsletter. So I'm glad to see that that came out via email, because that will give us an opportunity in the future to put those documents in newsletters and get that out to the people that need to see it. We're still researching the VTAC 34 edition and the 800 megahertz channels. Some of the discussions that came up there as far as the 800 meg channels is, do we say analog? Do we do digital? There's a lot of things that still need to be ironed out before we add those additional 800 meg channels to the ICS 217A form once that comes to life. And so that's a work in progress. So I think that's about it for the report, other than we are adding another technology committee call. So we're going from one call a month to two calls. And unfortunately, we had a situation come up here, and I couldn't attend the first the first of our two calls here. But ultimately, we will have two calls per month for the technology committee, which is posted to the web page. Questions?
Question for Pat. Okay, Pat, thank you.
Thanks.
We'll move on to the broadband, FirstNet broadband. If Rick, we'll just lead right into your, I believe you have a presentation for an update on FirstNet in Iowa.
Yes, good morning, board members. We have a brief update from the FirstNet broadband committee. If we can have, do I need to do anything, Sean, or are we okay? I'll wait for the presentation to come up. TurboTax. That's not my presentation, but it's a good idea to get your taxes done soon. Hey, this is just a kind of a summary report of some of the work that's happened over the past 2 to 3 months in the FirstNet Broadband Committee. But we're now getting close, very close to a lot less talk and a lot more action when it comes to the FirstNet conversation, as they have now gone through the RFP process. I have not awarded the vendor yet at this time. However, there is a presumptive awardee, and that presumptive awardee is AT&T. And it's because no one else made it through all the gauntlet up until that point. There's one telecommunications vendor who came probably, I don't want to call it a close second quite yet, but they actually filed a lawsuit because they weren't allowed to pass to the last round of evaluation, and that was Rivada. And so there is a court case that is supposed to be rectified. Some a hearing is supposed to happen sometime in the March timeframe that would resolve that issue. But it looks like whether or not they award it or not, when you have one horse left in the race, that's the one that's most likely going to get the award. So that would most likely be AT&T would be the prime vendor for FirstNet, for the FirstNet network nationwide, 50 states, five territories, and so on. So what does that mean for us? Well, it's good news that the RFP process has come to a close and we can get going on this. I don't know that it's good news that AT&T is the vendor at this point. We don't know. We won't know if AT&T is a good choice until the state plan is presented to the state. The draft state plan is presented to us, and we can actually evaluate to find out if the prime vendor produced something that is beneficial to law enforcement and beneficial for the state in general. And so that's going to comprise the majority of my conversation with you here today. Do I need to move this forward, or are you going to do this for me, Sean? I do it. Oh, Sean's doing it. Okay. Let's get, so these four things I'll talk about, the revised FirstNet state plan approval process, the FirstNet opt-out plan, the FirstNet public-private partnership summit that we have scheduled, and a FirstNet in Iowa newsletter. Four items, but it will not take long. The first one with the state plan approval process, we have an adopted process that the FirstNet Broadband Committee has created that walks us through the entire process should we opt in and stay on that current course. We've laid it all the way out to the process will drop into the SPOC, and then on down it goes, a very detailed process. And so we have that laid out right now, and we did make a moderate change to that. We added notification to the state's wireless entities, not just the telecommunications sector in the private space of telcos, but we also want to make certain that the wireless communities, and there's a huge group of wireless companies. You have your top two, AT&T and Verizon. You have Sprint and T-Mobile kind of sandwiched in the middle. But then you have this whole plethora of middle-range wireless carriers. Many of them have services in Iowa. And we don't know that they've necessarily had a great ear to this process until now. And now they're perking up very strongly, asking big questions. And we're trying to make certain that we keep the wireless community and the wireline community both engaged in this conversation fully. I'm going to give the board a brief update on what the state plan looks like in 100 seconds. So, Sean, if you could play that video for them, please.
Dedicated to public safety. Once built, the network will be a game changer, connecting millions of first responders with innovative technologies and applications. The network will enhance their ability to keep our communities safe and secure. As a key next step for this network, FirstNet is moving forward on developing state plans for all 56 states and territories. In these plans, FirstNet will outline how they can deploy the radio access network to provide the best coverage, capacity, and service for public safety users in the state or territory. Upon receipt of the FirstNet plan, the governor will have 90 days to choose whether to participate in the plan provided by FirstNet or develop its own plan for RAN deployment. A state should consider many factors in making this decision, such as the cost, technical challenges, and risk of building and maintaining its own RAN. By adopting the FirstNet plan, key benefits will include the faster delivery of broadband services to public safety and no deployment costs for the state. To prepare for the state plan decision, public safety can play a role by helping to educate key state officials and decision makers about the benefits of FirstNet in their state. Also, as the future users of the network, the public safety community should work with their state points of contact and FirstNet on the services and customer experience they want from the FirstNet network. To learn more, please visit www.firstnet.gov.
Rehash the process that will be going
nationwide broadband network dedicated.
I'm not going to rehash the approval process. We've already talked about it here with the board, but we're now in that window. We'll just need to keep it up to date. And if you take a look at your screen right now, that is what the actual process looks like right now. This is the state plan approval process. It allows us to go all the way from the very initial information coming down to the SPOC, all the way down to where the governor would issue the final decision via the electronic portal. So what this really comes down to is if we do our job correctly and we follow this process map all the way through, the state's telecommunication industry and the state government and the public safety stakeholders will have ample time to see it, review it, and we would not suppose that if this plan is in the affirmative for us, that we would wait past day one of that 90-day period. We would have the governor signal immediately and deployment would begin. So that's really where we're at right now. We're waiting for the draft state plan to come down. It'll go through a review process. And then provided that that is done in the affirmative, then we'll wait for the final state plans to drop across all the states and territories. And we would prepare our governor's administration for an affirmation on day one. And then it would go. However, the other part, I'd like to go to the next slide, if we would. I'd like you to take a look at this and please excuse the graphics. However, this diagram shows another option, and the FirstNet Broadband Committee voted to establish an opt-out plan. We need a roadmap in the event that a red button scenario does exist. And we don't anticipate this. Our desire would be not to build a network. The desire would be to have FirstNet build the network, and public safety in the state of Iowa gets to simply have another option to choose for their broadband cellular service. And that would be our desire to go down that route. But in the event that AT&T drops a boat anchor on the state of Iowa in way of a state plan, we need an option. And the option is not to allow FirstNet to deploy a network that would be substandard, not effective, or doesn't meet the coverage criteria or the usage type criteria that has been submitted over the years of data collection and process like this. And if they give us a plan that isn't good, we have to have a trajectory to go down. And here's what this would look like. So if you take a look at this graphic, at the very beginning, we have the governor's state plan review. And if that review, if we recommend to the governor, governor, we don't think this is good paper. We don't think this is beneficial to the public safety stakeholders in the state of Iowa. We need another option, and here's what we do. We would then divert from the opt-in path and go down an opt-out path. And if you follow this, this is what this shows. The governor would have to immediately send an opt-out notification to FirstNet, and we would begin the process of establishing a state RFP to go out. And this would not just be a statewide RFP, it'd be an RFP from the state, but it'd be national in scope because we'd be looking for solutions that would have to come in and provide the same, similar, equal to, or better than the state plan that they had offered. And we have 180 days to develop street and get that back, evaluate it, the whole nine yards. So that's a six-month window. It's doable. The broadband committee right now is considering putting together an RFP framework in advance just so we have one ready so we don't have to greenfield an entire RFP. We can look at what New Hampshire has done and some other states like that so that we would just be prepared. Again, it's not our desire to opt out, but we need to have those contingencies in place just in case. But after that process, we have an RFP. Here's what that evaluation then has to go through. Step one would be an FCC review. Number two would be the NTIA has to actually approve the process and be willing to fund a grant for that process out of the spectrum funds. And then we would have to go to NTIA to actually lease the spectrum to say that we can actually have spectrum to be able to utilize. Then we get to go to FirstNet and lease back their Band 14 spectrum. So we still have to go to the shop, even if you don't want to buy there. We still have to go to the shop to get all the stuff we need to do it ourselves. Then we have to go through all the environmental compliance, the NEPA stuff that the state of Iowa has already passed that hurdle. We've already done the NEPA evaluations already, and then we'd have to do that all again. So it is a tough road to hoe when you go down that aspect, but we need the plan nonetheless. So the FirstNet Broadband Committee is right now putting together not only what the Fed's requirement is for an opt-out pathway, but what would our pathway be in an opt-out scenario, and put us, maybe not develop it 100%, but have a developed process that in the event we get that draft state plan, that we don't have to start creating something from nothing in that type of a process if it's a boat anchor. And I can't tell the chair why I'm concerned about that right now. It could be my history working with AT&T over 30 years in the telecom industry. But I would hope that it is a beneficial state plan for the state of Iowa. But in the event it's not, we need to be prepared. So that is my presentation to the board on the opt-out roadmap. So the next slide, please. So the opt-out process will ensure that Iowa is prepared for both an opt-in and an opt-out scenario. And the first broadband committee is to prepare a contingency plan in order to incorporate both plans. And we will present this opt-out plan at our next public-private partnership that is slated for April. Next slide, please. We have our next summit coming up here shortly. Just to give you a background, we began these summits in March of 2015. We did two in 2015, two in 2016, and we're now into our fifth public-private partnership summit coming up in April, where we will present this opt-out scenario should that happen. And we will do this with full integration and notification with the private sector also of what's going on. It's Thursday, April 6th at the Grimes State Office Building. A video streaming will be available, and we're having panelists be queued up right now for that process. And last item for the board, I wanted to, we feel that over-communication is the name of the game in this. If we under-communicate the idea of FirstNet, that's our bad. So we're going to talk about it till people are sick of hearing about it. But we're about to break into a new era of the FirstNet conversation. There's been talk, what if, it could be. Some people don't believe it'll ever happen. But the minute that state plan drops onto this state, it's game on. We're in the deployment process at that point, and we're not talking about it anymore. We're doing it. And so at that point, we're developing a FirstNet in Iowa newsletter, electronic newsletter. We're working with the OCIO to use all the tools that we have available for GovList delivery and processes like that. But we want to be able to over-communicate what's happening with the FirstNet deployment the minute we get into that first state plan process. So when that draft hits, we're going to begin communicating statewide at that process, because now we're in deployment. When that plan is on the table here and hits Chair Lampe's web app, it's game on. So we want to begin communicating in a very intentional way at that process. So the board felt that it would be very beneficial to launch a electronic newsletter communication specifically on the progress of FirstNet as it is laid out. So we're in the process of putting that together. And that would conclude my report on from the FirstNet Broadband Committee. But I would entertain any questions if you have any from the board.
Okay, we talk about the draft plan and the state plan. From the time that the prime vendors identified and awarded the contract, what's the timeline from a draft plan to the actual state plan? And then obviously we know what the governor's timeline is once that's received. Is there any indication yet?
The answer to that is no. There is no timeline as to when we will have the state plan. Any money I would have, I would put on the fact that AT&T is developing the state plans right now and have been since probably December. But they have, they said in the video it's 56, it's really 50 states plus six territories, and they are in the process of developing those state plans right now. We assume they're going to drop them together as a group, as they will also do the final state plans. But when that draft hits us, they haven't indicated to us how long of a review period we'll have for the draft. It could be 30, 60, 90. It wouldn't be longer than that, I promise you. They have given us 30-day windows in the past to respond to things. So it could be as short as that. We would be fine with that, and we're prepared for that if that's the case. Our broadband committee has the team set up to go. The minute that thing hits, we have a 7-day warning window, and we will begin convening and dissecting the state plan to ensure it's good for the state of Iowa. After that point, the final state plan, we know that's a 90-day window when that drops. But we don't know what the difference is between the state plan, the draft, and the final state plan. So that's still unknown. Okay. You had a question, sir?
Yeah, Rick. I posed a question to Helen earlier, and with your work that you're doing with the with the broadband network, I guess I pose the same question to you. What knowledge do you have? I mean, because I know that when I attended that PSCR conference a couple years back, they talked about the technology of being there. Provide the push to talk on LTE. What do you have on that?
The message between 4G LTE and 5G is very stark. It's very different, and there's some very defined roadmaps that they're on right now. But there's some structural reasons why 4G, and the FirstNet network is a 4G LTE network, but FirstNet is not trying to go push to talk on this network, and they won't go until the whole thing could be flashed up to 5G anyway. And there's some reasons. The 5G isn't here yet, and 4G is, and they need this network in place. But they're not trying to create a push-to-talk network. They're trying to create a data network. Right. And 4G is effective for that. But there's some reasons why 4G will not work for push-to-talk. The difference is, one of the main differences, if you were all cell towers and this person wanted to talk to Jeff, you wanted to talk to Jeff and you're on the same tower, all that routing has to go all the way back to the core and then come back out to the same tower to go back out to the person. 5G technologies allow to utilize what you guys do now in the radio industry, is go from, you're on the same tower, you're able to communicate in the same frequency without going back to some core, and you're able to intercommunicate directly in the radio spectrum. 5G is built that way. And so this goes from, just to put it in rough terms, 5G is 500 times faster for setup than LTE is now. 4G LTE is now. And because of that, the call setup to use push-to-talk over 4G really isn't practical. And people play some games with some applications, but the base transport of 4G LTE cannot sustain push-to-talk mission-critical conversations because of that setup. So 5G is 1 millisecond response time for call setup. LTE 4G is 500 times slower than that. And that is why 4G will not be used for push-to-talk mission-critical setup in any meaningful, widespread, interoperable use. There may be some people using apps in this way, but technically it's not going to be at the level of mission-critical push-to-talk. That will not happen until 5G comes. So here's where we're at with the 5G networks. There's been process going on. The biggest hurdle that went that happened was in the Rio Games last summer. So the Summer Games of 2016 was a huge test bed for 5G. The next set will be in Pyeongchang in South Korea in the 2018 games. They're doing another whole test bed of 5G operations in South Korea. The next one will be the 2020 games in Tokyo, will be the final culmination of 5G standards and operations. And so we're about 3 years away from the 5G standard operation processes. And whatever comes out of the Tokyo game studies that happened in 2020, and I think there are summer games in 2020, will be the culmination. The boards are all meeting and they're ratifying standards and everything at that point. Then it'll be 5G game on. You may hear Verizon is starting to do 5G implementations in certain processes. They're taking hedge bets on where the standards are going to lie. So they'd rather take the risk in being a market shaper and getting out in front of there, hoping that they go that way. But they could get caught with their pants down if the international standard of 5G tweaks itself by the time 2020 rolls around. So I will tell you, we'll have finished standards on 5G by mid-year 2020, and then it'll be the manufacturer simply deploying at that point. But that's why you will not see push to talk inside 4G LTE in a sustainable mission critical format. It simply can't set up the calls because it has to go all the way back to the cores and back out where 5G runs on SDN. And so it's all software, it's flexible, it's fast, and it allows for intercellular switching without having to go back to some other place. So when that stabilizes in 2020, I think we will see massive movements in the mission critical process. FirstNet's message is still 3 years ago, they said 10 years, and they're probably right on track with that. But that was 3 years ago. I'll tell you that they're actually moving the 5G message stronger and faster right now. So I think you'll see a stabilized 5G infrastructure in 3 years.
Thank you.
That's my report.
Okay.
On to information sharing. I'll open it up to the board members. Do you have anything you want to share amongst each other? News, LMR, FirstNet, anything? Okay. If we could get an update from Motorola, please.
All right, good morning. This will be another quick update. We just have two slides I wanted to present here. First of all, as we look at the overall project, this chart here is the completely collapsed Gantt chart for the overall project, which is about 1,000 lines right now that we're tracking as the overall project. So just a couple of things I want to point out here is on each region that I have here, 1 through 6, we show on this Gantt chart the percentage of the tasks, the percentage of the tasks performed to date. So this is not, for example, region one, it says 39%, doesn't mean that 39% of the sites are done. It just means that 39% of the tasks associated with all the sites is done. Every site is unique and different. Some require regulatory approvals that are different and unique for that particular area. Some of them have to do with historical aspects. Others have to do with environmentals. Others are more localized, so it varies. So we can't really have an apples-to-apples comparison, so we show it this way instead. I guess the thing I want to point out here is that from all of the regions, here, region 6, 47 is the one that's been that we've been able to advance the most. We have a lot of activities going on, but overall, all of them center, between roughly, 35 to 40% is where we are in average. If you look at on a per regional basis, right now we have, I'm showing here, we got 26 active construction sites throughout the state, and region 6 is the one that's the most active right now with 8 construction activities going on. Overall, we have 37, in addition to these 26, we have 37 sites throughout the states that are locked and ready to go. We expect to be able to get approval for these sites, but we can't move until the approval is actually provided. But all the paperwork has been submitted. Everything is looking good for these sites so far. So once we get the approvals on these, and we're going to hit the road running pretty quickly with these as well. So now with the spring coming, we expect to be busy at least twice as much as we were in Q4 of last year. These construction activities vary the actual digging out the foundations to pouring concretes. In some cases, we've actually dropped the shelters in place. We built towers. Others, we are waiting for final approval so we can strengthen existing towers. So it's quite a mixture throughout the state, but we're definitely pretty busy.
Melvin, is it true, I think you've reported to us before, that you've preloaded the huts, and so when the tower's up and ready to go, you literally are ready to rock and roll within just a few days after that to turn on dial tone and begin testing? And so it's equipment that's already been tested. We came and saw that. It's been shipped here. It's now been installed. So things are, I guess my term is, you've got your foot on the gas as soon as we can get the appropriate tower sites up, and we should begin to see a lot more action in some areas very quickly.
Yes, fair. We have shelters that are completely loaded and packed and ready to go. We have a schedule of shelters that we have ready to be picked up as soon as we get some of these approvals in place. The biggest round of activities that you're going to see is the installs of the actual microwave dishes. We've received all the microwave equipment at the warehouse, and we're bursting at the seams. We got 8-foot dishes, 6-foot dishes, and 4-foot dishes. And when you go in there, you literally see walls and walls of stuff all over the place that we're anxious to get out of there and actually put them on the tower. So that's one of the things that we're going to start doing up in the coming couple of weeks. We're coordinating, getting ready for that task right now. But for as far as the equipment and shelters, they're pretty much ready. Then we're going to start organizing for some of the existing locations where we do co-locations. Those are a little bit more time consuming, so we're trying to get all the pre-done stuff out the door first.
But really, your delays here are paperwork.
Yes, it's always a paperwork.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Melvin, once you get the site up, is it usable? Does it have to be, or do we have to wait for a ring to be completed? I get a lot of questions on that.
So there's several ways to use the site. So if the site is not connected into the ring, because you know, a ring can take 8 sites to make it all the way up to the core, what we're able to do is enable the site to start operating in what we call site trunking, which is basically a site that allows people to communicate with each other among that site itself. But we need the sites to be interconnected so that the sites, so people from different sites can talk to each other as well. So we have functionality, it's limited functionality, but we do have functionality at that point that whatever coverage that that particular site provides can be used for locals if they need to use it.
Okay. Back to Craig's point, we're on track for July of 18.
Yes, we're on track. We've had some challenges with some sites that have fallen off for the same reason. We failed NEPAs, we failed SHPOs, and in some cases we are on the 6th site attempt to alternative sites to be able to come up with a better solution.
But that's normal.
That's normal, yes.
You're going to have that with any other state. You go build a, with this size, you're bound to have a few that aren't going to make it.
Yes, yes. The biggest challenge for us, or the surprise, has been the amount of airports throughout the state of Iowa, which airports, as long as it's registered, it doesn't matter if it's just a landing strip with grass, it's considered an airport. So that sort of tied our hands on some of the sites that we had selected that get knocked down for that reason. But other than that, it's just the regular push and shove of the regulatory process.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks, Melvin.
Move on to old business. Craig, I'll let you continue with your ISSI discussion if you have any more on that regarding your summit and your eventual goals.
Yeah, I think the documents that I'm looking to send out will be reviewed by the CIO since it is, he and I have been collaborating on this. But the location's locked down, the time is locked down, the invitees of who needs to be in the room so that the summit is productive and valuable are locked down. So then it's a matter of getting the constant contact information set up with Sean to collect that and be able to put that part of the logistics together. So at this point, I'm pretty comfortable with where we are. The thing I'm uncomfortable with is the population. We've only got seating, as you look around this room, for maybe 100 people. And even at that, it's pretty cozy. So if we get a big audience, we probably will have to just have some people watch it from YouTube, or we may even be able to do something live with it like we do with this meeting. But we'll see what that looks like. But that's, Sean's been working closely with me in West Des Moines to see that we can make this come off elegantly and successfully the first time, and then use that as a footprint for going forward. Because there are other states. I know I've talked to our OEC coordinator, and there are other states that want to come in and participate. And I'm not sure how we're going to accommodate that. If we've got local users, they'll have to be first, and then perhaps they'll be able to watch it from someplace else. But that's kind of what we're working on. So that's probably the biggest part of the update.
So you were tasked with the CIO to come up with the solution for our ISSI that we're afforded per the contract. Is it your hope to vet that out through this summit in order to make that decision for
right.
the board?
There's a lot of opinion about how it might be used, and since we've only got one, that's really our challenge, is that it's not like we got 35, and we're choosing to use 6 or 7 of them. We've got one. And everything from the use of it for WAVE for investigations, there's even been discussion, would it make more sense to trade that for something else of greater value in the interoperability community? And then, so that's part of what we expect to come out of this summit, is an understanding of what an ISSI will and won't do within the context of a TDMA to FDMA system and the VHF analog and digital that we've got across the state. So it is no insignificant conversation. A lot of people in this room, their eyes will roll back in their head if they come to it. It's going to get very technical very quick. And that's where we need to be able to get the engineering teams to agree that this can and should be done, and here's what the standard allows, and here's how it works. That's been part of the challenge, is that we're so far out on the forefront when you start interfacing a TDMA wide area system with FDMA small systems. It's not being done right now. FDMA to FDMA is done in a lot of places. But when you go TDMA to FDMA and you start saying, well, will it do this? Well, they say it should. The standard says so. Well, that's not good enough, because we don't want to be relying on that and then find out it doesn't work. So that's where we're at.
Okay, Tracy, are you still here? Tracy's our chair of our working group for our policies that we have to establish here for talking on the network. And
I apologize. I've been out most of January, early February, because of some family emergencies. Sometimes when it rains, it pours. And so I'm going to be working really aggressively trying to get caught up and getting these done for y'all. I'm going to work with Swick Allen to see if he wants anything for this for his summit, and just make sure those are done first, and then just try to get them to Chair Lampe as soon as possible. And Terry McCullen has been really good, and so we're going to just continue to work forward on this, make sure that we catch anything that we need to, in terms of funding, be able to justify it, because some of the standards and policies we might not be able to be completed because we don't have funding to make sure, such as the status board. We need to be able to secure funding. So if we be able to justify it through a standard or policy, perhaps we can get funding elsewhere. So we want to bring those to attention to the board so we can secure the necessary funding to move forward and be the best we can. So.
Okay.
That's it. Any questions? Thank you.
Thanks, Tracy. We know you've had your hands full. Thank you very much.
I want to move on to item C for the SWCC replacement. I'll give you an update on that. The paperwork is at DAS. I've received an email from the reviewer the other day with a few questions on that. I've answered those and sent it back. So now it's the waiting. When if she's satisfied with those answers, that paperwork will get forwarded to Department of Management. When Department of Management signs off on it, which I hope would be in the next week or so, it'll come back that it's been approved and we can post it for that purpose for the SWCC then on the website and the DAS website. So that's the update on that. The other thing that we need to maybe think about here, since it does take longer and we anticipated this was going to happen, it isn't a fast process to try to get the switch FTEs around and to establish that as we're experiencing. Do we need to look at the SWCC contract ends April 7th? Now, if there is something in the contract that allows us upon a mutual agreement between both parties to extend that, I think we should explore that, and that's my opinion only. I would like to get your ideas on maybe pushing that on a month by month until we have, so because the intent is to have a little bit of overlap here with our SWCC and the new SWCC, whoever that may be. The time is crunched here, and if Federal Engineering is willing and we can do it legally in our current contract, we did it with Jim Bogner. We extended that 4 months in order for that overlap to occur. So I'd like some input on that, if that's even possible, or should we just cut it at April 7th and hope we get this back here? So I'll open it up for questions or comments on that.
If possible, I think you have to do it. But it's a question of, does the contract allow it?
Right. So I'm looking into that. I have to call Federal Engineering. I just wanted to, if the board would even entertain me even looking into that, would be my first step. My question to the board is, should we even entertain that?
Tom, this is Kelly on the phone. I would definitely entertain that and concur with John there.
Okay. Anybody else? Any input on that?
I concur. Getting up to speed for anybody that would, even if they were remotely familiar with what we're doing here, would still take them quite a while. So I would definitely say that some overlap would be good.
Okay. So I will check in the contract and run it through legal, and we'll discuss it with Federal Engineering, and I'll let you know. I'll do that as quickly as possible. I'll send an email out and proceed with that. If I have to call a board meeting, I may do that to get approval for some funding, because we do have to pay monthly, so that would occur. So it would, but it's all going to start with whether we can even do it. So it may be a moot point. So, Thank you. The admin rule change, I think we've covered, John. I'm going to do that next time. New business, it's already 12:10. I do want to, kind of excited about what I'm going to talk about here, and I want to get your input on it. Our mission with the board, and as your leader, under 8028 and 29, I read that a lot, and that's a pretty heavy lift when it comes to what we're obligated to do as this board. And we've accomplished a lot of things here since 2007. And the ultimate objective in that, and it says ultimate objective of this board is to create this system. We're there. We're building this system. So when the system's done, then what? We still have to have interoperability and be able to talk on that system, because there will be people in PSAPs and those who chose not to join it operationally, but did choose to do it maybe with a portable so they can communicate. But is it our obligation? I believe it's our obligation to ensure and give them a path to be able to communicate on the system. And where I'm going with this is, everybody knows that Leah has been the solution for our interoperability to talk during an event, depending on where you're at, since the 70s. And I think we can explain how Leah works during a bank robbery up in the Maynard area during interoperability events like that. Leah suffered the same narrow banding that everybody else suffered. And that's just one problem. The biggest problem that I'm having now to keep Leah maintained is that 50-year-old copper circuit that goes to those sites, those repeater sites that are sitting out in the boonies. Every week I have a circuit down for Leah or our base, which is on the same tower. We spend about $450,000 a year just to keep those circuits lit, to keep Leah functioning. It's going to come to a point, and I've been discussing this with the vendors that supply our equipment. AT&T is one of them, CenturyLink, and then there's some mom-and-pop shops that supply that copper connection. They're just not going to fix it anymore. And the reason they're not going to fix it, because there's no parts to fix it. And every time it rains or that, just they're always out. So there will be a day, and I don't know what that day will be, but there will be a day where they won't come out and fix it because they can't. So now Leah's gone. So we have to start thinking about what's going to replace Leah. And one solution that I have is what we call a control station in our PSAPs. If we have a control station with any, doesn't matter what kind of control station, no matter what vendor, if it's Motorola, Harris, Midland, Johnson, whatever, if we have a control station in every PSAP that's tuned to, that can have the ability to speak on the statewide network during an interoperability event, because if you're dealing with a tornado, if you're dealing with a flood, either talking on the ground, mobile to mobile, portable to portable, or you're using your PSAP. For some way, shape, or form, the PSAP's always involved. So if there's a control station at every PSAP that's dialed into ISICS, whether it's live sitting on the top of the PSAP console, whether it's in the closet because you don't want to use it, you don't want the space, but you can get it and plug it in and talk during that event on our regional talk groups that we are establishing through the state, I think that's a plus. But it always comes down to how we're going to pay for this. So what I did is I looked in, and I'm putting my DPS hat on, so take my chair hat off. So as a DPS, we provided Leah for since the 70s. I'm writing a grant, and tomorrow's the deadline out. I'm about ready to hit the send button as DPS, apply for what they call a terrorism in community, how to combat terrorism in your community, and the plans for that. So it's a grant that it's got a $2.5 million ceiling on it. But the proposal that I've come up with is about $1.3 million. What it is if you want to combat terrorism and fight terrorism, you have to have a communication system to do that. And you got to be able to communicate in your community. And if you can communicate on the state system with a control station or whatever, or radios or whatever, that's a benefit to mitigate that event. And that's how I'm writing this grant. So that's one way to fund that program, to put a radio in every PSAP for those who are not joining the system for operational use or whatever reason. Because if you're joining it for operational use and you've made that decision as a county or city to roll your complete operations onto the system, that's great. You get the interoperability. You got it. But the ones that can't afford it, nor want to, for whatever reason, we still have to find and provide them a path, either with DPS or this board, to be able to talk on Essex. I think that that's one way of doing that. So I'm going to open up. First, I'll ask Wally if he's still here. Does this make, we talked a little bit about, can you explain how a control station works in a PSAP and the benefits of that, regardless of what make, model, or whatever it is, just the concept of it, in case you don't know what a control station is?
The term control station kind of gets thrown around, and there's a lot of different flavors. It's like an ice cream cone. There's a lot of ways to make it. But basically, it's a mobile radio that has a power supply that allows you to plug it into the wall and connect to an antenna system of some kind. Whether it's I've seen them as much as a magnetic mount antenna stuck to the ceiling. That's not always the ideal way to do it, but in times of disaster, sometimes that's how it's accomplished. To a managed system within the building that routes the RF outside of the building, but it's basically taking that mobile radio that's in your vehicle, runs on 12 volts or your 12 volt battery, and provide a power a nice looking and transportable way to take that power supply and the mobile radio with you. So, and usually there's ways to interface equipment in and out. So you can make it modular. It can sit on the desk and work itself. It can sit in the closet and be interfaced to your console equipment. If you have dispatchers sitting at consoles and they don't want to have a separate radio, they want to use their integrated headset, there's generally ways to do that of different flavors. But it gives you those options. Also, if you have to run out of the building for some reason for an emergency, it may have the ability to go with you, depending on how you configure it.
Okay.
Is that
what you're looking for? Perfect. So that, in essence, if Leah does go away, we have a backup plan for that, because it's in jeopardy. And we are going to tie it in with the gateways, the conventional. We are going to do that into the system, but you can't tie into something that doesn't work. So eventually it will fail and will need to be replaced. And the only other way to do it is we spend a tremendous amount of money and use microwave shots instead of the copper connections at those power sites, which is very expensive. So what I'm asking for the board is not only what I'd like to do is pass this on to the committees that are appropriately staffed and have the knowledge to look into this, and that would be finance, operations, and technology. And I believe, Patrick, if you're still on there, this kind of leads into how you want to interface this kind of thing into the state, how these PSAPs will interface. I think this is one way of doing that. So if you would discuss it on tech operations and finance a little bit more and see if, I think it's feasible, but if it's not, we'll move on. But I think that's a great way to make sure that we're abiding by the 80, 28, and 29. Yeah, we built it, but we still have to get people to talk on it, because if we're still having problems talking during events, we haven't solved it. And if we have the umbrella up and we can take advantage of that, that's gold. The big part's done. Now the little pieces, and I'm always going to rely on what Craig tells me, there's easy parts and there's hard parts, and the what we've been through, according to Craig, is the easy part. The hard part's when it's operational. So, and I'll just open that up for conversation. Thoughts, ideas?
That goes along to what we learned in Ohio. And Tom and I really haven't talked about that, but we went out to tour the state of Ohio's MARCS system, and that's multi-agency radio communication system. That's one of the things that they had a lot of success with, is that they provided a MARCS radio for all their PSAPs. And that's a system that's been up for 15 years now, or almost 15 years in the state of Ohio. And believe it or not, they don't have 100% buy-in. However, one of the things they've had success at is allowing system access at that PSAP level. You can't guarantee anybody's going to use it. But at the same time, they have access to it. It's portable. It's transportable. It can be taken out using at an ICP. You can use it at your EOC. You can use it right in your in your PSAP if needed. But we learned a lot while we were out there, but that's one of the things that was really, that really kind of shined out while we were there, was that that's one of the things they did, and that was one of their successes. And I would support however we could do that, whether it be through a grant or if we find some sort of sustainable funding stream in the near future. So
during the PSIC grant time, that was how some states attacked this, where they had a statewide system either in deployment or one that was already completed, and they went out and filled in the gaps, if you will, using the control station approach. And it seemed to really improve interoperability in those states when you start looking at the national assessments of where states are and who's furthest out to the right on the continuum. You're frequently finding those states that were able to take those big PSIC dollars and put them into radio equipment and get it out into everyone's hands. So that's kind of what you're, sounds like what you're trying to do here. I think it's a great idea.
So the biggest thing is I will submit this on DPS's behalf tomorrow, the grant for the terrorism in their communities, and to see how that goes. And then, but I, in the meantime, I would like those three committees to discuss this and explore other options in case that doesn't come to fruition. And there isn't a match, by the way, on this grant. There is no match. So I've written it up in such a way. Well, and it came right out and said there is no match. So we're good to go on that. So. Governance or operations, you okay with that? Okay. Patrick, you still on the phone?
Yep, I'll put it on the list.
Okay. And Kelly, I think you're on the phone. We heard that, so from the financial piece. And if anybody knows of any grants that are out there, because there's all kinds of them that come out, John, I'll push it to you. Is there anything that you can lead us to? That'd be great also if there's any funding available. Okay. All right, I think I've already discussed the contract with the SWCC, so we're on to the public comment. And I'll open it up to the floor. Go ahead, Wally. And then I'll get to Jim Lundstedt here also at the same time.
Standing in the way of lunch, so I will speak very quickly. Training Chair Pavlik, no intent to bypass her, but I did get an email late in the day yesterday from Colonel Rob Hedgepeth. He was just passing along the dates for the what he believes will be the National Guard's COMEX this coming fall. He says it's looking like it 7th and 8th of September at Camp Dodge. So kind of a save the date, more details to come. He says plans are in the works to have this exercise be scenario driven with a heavy emphasis on communications, including interoperable frequencies and civilian / military gateways. More details will be published. So if you or you know of people who COMELS, COMT trainees that need task book items signed, that's been an opportunity at those, as well as it's been if you're not in that category, but you want to see some of the interoperability of some of this equipment that gets talked about, you want to see what a control station does and how it can be connected, these are those kind of opportunities. So as everyone's schedule fills very quickly, he asked if I'd pass these along. So.
Okay. Anybody else before I have Jim come up? Okay, Jim, apologize I went past you, but
no worries.
Greg wrote me a nice little note here.
Chair Lampe, if I could tell you, the controls station scenario has been utilized successfully in Missouri with all of the PSAPs and all the 24-hour dispatch points, largely funded through PSIC, but also through Homeland Security grant program activities after construction of their system, and in Nebraska to put a control station in all of the regional dispatch centers to help ameliorate some of the concerns with the state radio system being in an entirely separate band and technology from a lot of local agencies. So I think that strategy is spot on for a long-term solution. It also lends itself to being technology agnostic, that at some point you may say, I no longer want to be just an interoperable user, but I want to be on a statewide system, and as a console user, that PSAP control station becomes a backup resource. So
right. Thinking
beyond the initial point. I just have three quick things. I previously briefed a couple of brief overviews of the Science and Technology Directorate's jamming exercise. The final after action report was issued was released in early February. I will get a copy to Chair or to SWCC Allen. It is public safety sensitive and talks about some things that are law enforcement sensitive. It was in spot on with what I told you about. Eyes open, understand that this threat is real. We're holding a test, training, and exercise follow-on in at Idaho National Labs in Idaho in July of this year to test some of the technologies and mitigation strategies that have been created. I've talked to a couple of defense contractors who have some very interesting ways of spotting jamming activity, and I hope that the report out will be useful and that we'll mitigate that before it becomes too widespread. In 2016, the National Governors Association entertained requests from all of the states for support in understanding challenges with interoperability. The five lanes of the interoperability continuum were the focus areas, and the states of Alaska, Hawaii, Idaho, Illinois, and West Virginia were selected by the NGA for these special workshops. The Office of Emergency Communications assisted with the facilitation and the report out. Those reports are going to the governors this week. I think you'll find some of the fact versus fiction about various technology things that you've talked about here today to be eye-opening. There's some very specific call-outs about what to think about, what you're doing with land mobile radio and sustainable funding, and where FirstNet fits into that. There's a very cool graphic that's been worked on that helps answer some of those questions. I'm not allowed to share that, but I think that I was actually one of the applicants for that particular NGA workshop. I think those will be offered to the governors in the very near term future, and you'll benefit from what it tells you. I think it was very, very eye-opening. You heard some of those states are very small, but our interoperability challenges are not really all that different. I'm going to touch on one other thing. We keep talking about interoperability for land mobile radio. I spent 3 hours yesterday in one of the major cities looking at interoperability for video cameras and license plate readers. Talk about a mucky mess. But while I was in that center, they made two felony arrests, rolling arrests on people off of fixed license plate readers. But the technology challenge is we got all this stuff and it doesn't talk. Does that sound familiar? Mm-hmm. Whether it's CAD, whether it's video, whether it's LMR or broadband, these challenges are going to be with us for some time. And it's just a matter before the next technology is in EMS or emergency management or fire. But that one was particularly salient to me because I was watching 10 rolling LPRs, didn't touch a hit. And the fixed sites were grabbing these things just like that. We saw 57 active hits in 3 hours. Now, the point is, was that interoperability? Of course it was. But we don't think of it in a day-to-day basis like that. Finally, I want to emphasize the importance of getting your SCIP request and your technical assistance request into us. The federal government is operating in a what we call a continuing resolution, meaning our budget is somewhat constrained through April, but we're beginning to try to schedule activities now for 2017 to be delivered by the end of the year. And the sooner you get those in, the sooner we can get them under consideration. Any questions for me?
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, motion for adjournment.
We're gonna hang around. We're all gonna hang around.
We're gonna hang around?
No, we're gonna hang around. So moved.
Okay. All right, we're adjourned.
Carol second.